Welcome everyone to this special Warren lecture. I have the honor to introduce our speaker today, Professor Constantinos Antoniou. Professor Antoniou is a professor in the chair of transportation systems engineering at the Technical University of Munich. He has his bachelor's degree in civil engineering from the National Technical University in Athens and a master's and PhD both in transportation systems from MIT. Professor Antoniou is a very prolific scholar with, I think I saw over 400 publications, many of them well over 100 in academic journals and over 250 in conference proceedings. So I'm very pleased to be able to invite Professor Antoniou to give our Warren seminar. Let's please join me in virtually welcoming Professor Antoniou. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Professor Stern. Thank you, Rafael. It's a great pleasure to be here and talk to you about some recent research that I've been working on, and in fact, about the impacts of automation in future public transport systems. For those that know me and my background, this is not one of my core areas, but it has been developing. And what I'm going to do, considering also that I understand that this is not, you know, a lecture in a transportation specific audience, I will try to be a little bit broader and discuss about a few of the current activities that we have, the projects. And of course, during the questions and answer, I'm willing to go deep in any of these. So half of this slide has already been talked, so I can skip it just to say that before coming to Germany, I was in Greece, a professor in the faculty in Greece at the National Technical University of Athens, and then visiting professor at EPFL and ATH. And also you can see me without the corona hair here, and how I will hopefully become in a few years again. And of course, you know, this research is not my research, it's the research of, first of all, my group in Munich, which now has 5 postdocs and more than 10 PhDs, and of course, many other people who we collaborate with, like visiting professor Alejandro Tirachini, who is, we have worked together in some of the research I'm going to mention today, but many other people as well. Now, I'm going to start by saying, because it's always a question, oh, automated cars, every year for the last 10 years, in 2 years, automated cars would dominate the world. And I had this discussion with everybody. They were saying, oh, 2016, they will be here. 2017, 2018. I was like, I mean, look around, come on. We have to be here. So when I am talking about the things that I will be talking, I want to preface them by some reality check. And the way I choose to do the reality check, you'll see in a second. I just want to lighten the mood and say, okay, we have a very uncertain future ahead of us, not what you think, but other things. So, I mean, many decades ago, we were promised autonomous cars, flying cars, etc. And indeed, there has been a lot of progress in this direction, but still it's at its infant. And I like to compare this to machine learning. And machine learning, artificial intelligence rather, is changing the world since the 1960s. Now, after 60 years, it's starting to really give some practical results. And also part of the of this is shown in autonomy. But the way that I try to use to show, I mean, an instrument I try to use in order to show this uncertainty is by looking at a meta-analysis of the state of the art of research regarding the impacts of shared autonomous vehicles. And this is a paper that we wrote very recently this year with two of my students. One, Manos Haniotakis, has left to become a lecturer at University College London, and Santana Krishna Narayanan, this was his master's, part of his master's work, stayed on with me for his PhD. So here we see, in terms of trying to by summarizing the studies that look at the travel behavior impacts, for example, the expected vehicle kilometer changes or vehicle miles traveled in the future due to the introduction of shared autonomous vehicles, they range between plus 90% and minus 45%. Of course, there are different parameters, there are different conditions, different time frames, different, but this shows you the usual thing, that there's lies, there's big lies, and then there's statistics. And I love statistics, and I say it with a lot of love, okay? Another example is the vehicle replacement rate. So many people are saying, oh, when automated vehicles are going to come, we will not have to buy our own car and there will be a fleet of vehicles circulating and serving our needs. But still, we see that the replacement rates range from a little bit above 1 up to 11. So there is a huge margin here and we have to be very careful about how we handle it. And of course, the answer that I have when people tell me, okay, and now, so what? What do you choose? 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, or 11? The answer is sensitivity analysis, but that's a different story. The last point that I use from this is the cost per kilometer that we can expect from these kind of vehicles. And I'm mentioning this because it will become relevant in some of the analysis later. So here we see again the numbers range from 11 cents per kilometer to more than $1 per kilometer. And again, I'm the first to clarify, these are under different conditions, different parameters, different, but still it's an order of magnitude. Now, the first case study that I'm going to talk about is from an automated shuttle service in Barkarby in Stockholm in Sweden. And all over the world, there are short-term pilots where they bring these shuttles and they move them around for a couple of hours or a couple of days or a couple of weeks. And it's great. Here, it's greater, I think, because they actually have deployed a number of such shuttles at the edge of their public transport system in a newly developed area that is growing rapidly, but they have integrated it into the public transport system and it is operating as a feeder to bigger lines. So it is a service that you pay for, it is a service that it works, it operates on the road along with other vehicles with a headway of 10, 15 minutes. It started with 15 kilometers per hour and it's increasing, it's gonna reach 25 kilometers per hour at some point this year, presumably, and so on. And we were lucky to have access to three waves of surveys that were done to the, I wouldn't say to the users of the service, to the people living, operating, working in this area. So we get both users and non-users. And this is some research that has been done. You will see, I mean, let me skip forward. And you can see here the name. So my postdoc, Gia Guo, the first author, has had access to the data. Yusak Susilo, who was at KTH and is now at Boku in Vienna, and Anna Pernerstahl-Brenden, who is at KTH. So this is the group. They collected the data and we have access to them and we're contributing to the analysis. So we have three waves that have been done in 2019 in March, September, and December, each of these with more than 500 participants. And in the end, we have more than 300 participants that have completed all three waves. And there are the surveys have a different intent, different focus. The first one looks more at behavioral intention. So for example, the awareness of the people about the frequency, about safety, about the willingness to use. The second one about the willingness to use and the willingness to recommend the service to the others, how this can, you know, expand. And in the third one, there are also some SP experiments. I'm not going to talk about the third one. I'm going to show what we have been doing with the first two. So the first thing is that we tried to, looking at the first wave, where we collect some perceptions of the various, not users, but people around the people working or living in this area, both users and non-users. We did some analysis, factor analysis, some simple models and so on, as discussed. I'm not going now to a lot of depth so that I can give like the picture that I want, but I'm gladly go more, or you can of course look at the references. And it seems that people perceive a longer travel time for the automated vehicles compared to the conventional vehicles. And also lower reliability, which is also stronger for non-users, which is positive because it means that, okay, if I haven't used the service, I think it might be less reliable than conventional buses. But if I'm using it, then maybe I feel more comfortable. I understand, I realize that it looks okay, robust and solid, etc. And this is a positive thing. And in terms of safety, it seems that travelers really believe that the presence of an onboard steward is important. This is very important, and we will come back to this later when we talk about the economics of automation in public transport, because that was one of the assumptions that were done in the past, that, you know, the cost of autonomy will be very low of offering automated services, because okay, the vehicles are going to be expensive in the beginning, but later they will drop a lot in price as everything, but you eliminate the human cost. And this does not seem to be the case. Maybe you'll have people who are less skilled on the vehicle. Maybe you have people at a remote operation center that monitor 5 or 10 shuttles, and you know, the passenger can see them and talk to them, so understand there is somebody there. But it seems it's not that simple. We don't eliminate personnel cost. Now, from the second wave, the analysis that we are doing is we're trying to understand whether they have a number of hypotheses, whether the attitudes, the subjective norms, and the travel needs of the individuals, how they influence the behavior intention. So how do I how do people indicate that they intend to use this new service or not? And also their willingness to recommend the service to others. And then we also combine this information with the actual behavior. And once we add the actual behavior, what we can do is we can see how the behavior intention converts into actual behavior. And unfortunately, as you might have feared or guessed, this is for me an important thing and discouraging, that there does not seem to be a very strong link between behavior intention and actual behavior. And this is something that we see before. So we see a lot of papers saying, oh, urban air mobility, 30% of future trips will be done by flying taxis, because that's what people responded in a questionnaire, or many other things like that. Hyperloop, the same thing. I mean, of course, if you ask people right now about a mode that does not exist and will not exist in 10, 20 years, what are you going to do? You can expect some discrepancy. And this is, unfortunately, something we have to deal with, especially in how we use our research in informing policy. And then what the other thing that we notice is that between attitudes, between subjective norms and needs, needs are by far the most important factor that influences behavior intention and the willingness to recommend. The willingness to recommend is also influenced by the other components, but the behavioral intention is primarily informed by our needs. Now I'm moving to a next step that actually uses some of these concepts that we have discussed, even though it was done before, but I'm trying to tell a story now, not linked to the time that the research was done necessarily. And again, this is work led by Professor Alejandro Tiracchini from the University of Chile, who was a visiting professor at my chair and also a Humboldt fellow at my chair. Now, don't be worried by these equations. I have a few more that I'm going to talk about. We can get back to this if there is some interest. I will try to use few of them to make a few points that I want to make. So first of all, we are talking about the total cost. So we are making an analytical model of the total cost of offering a public transport service. And we are saying that this total cost has to do with the operator cost, which is a function of the cost per bus, per vehicle kilometer, per vehicle hour, actually, times the fleet size. Then there is a parameter of the access cost. So what is the cost for the users to reach the bus stop? Then there is the waiting time cost. So once the users have reached the bus stop, they have to wait a little bit, and this time is money. And then there is the in-vehicle time cost, so the time that they spend in the vehicle. And again, when we try to parameterize this a little bit more, we first of all drop the access cost because we assume that the bus stops are pretty much going to stay the same. So it will not really affect, the access time is not going to change when we add automation. There are exceptions to this. This is not necessarily the case always, but let's for now remove this. And then we are, essentially what we are doing is we are saying that the cycle time is one parameter that matters. So the operator cost is affected by the fixed cost of the operator per bus plus a variable cost. And the cycle time also affects this cost, because if you have longer, if your cycle time increases, your cost increases. Then similarly for the waiting time, we have another factor. I don't want to spend a lot of time defining everything, but if you think it's useful, either interrupt me now or we can discuss it in the Q&A. And in the end, also the in-vehicle time is affected both by the running time and also by the boarding and alighting time. And then there are various assumptions on how different types of vehicles can affect these parameters. And we minimize this cost, because that's our objection. The objection is to minimize the cost. And from that, we derive formulas for the optimal frequency and optimal vehicle size. We are still talking about conventional vehicles, and that's why I'm a little bit fast. These are based on the literature. There is nothing really, innovative, especially innovative here. But the interesting thing, okay, and here there is some more information on how we can derive a first best public transport fare based on the literature, and then how we can derive optimal subsidy per trip. The point is that when we add, when we model automation as well, we want to compare what we can achieve with automation versus what we can achieve with conventional buses, with respect also to the optimal price and to the optimal subsidy. So now we are adding vehicle automation. So now we take the previous things, which of course I don't expect you to have fully assimilated yet, but we are saying that we have this cost, and the cost of offering the bus service has a fixed component and a variable component of the cost. And then we are saying that for automated vehicles, we add this bar on top of the total cost, of the fixed cost, and of the variable cost. And we are saying that we can approximate these by introducing a variable alpha and beta here, which gives you the percentage. So alpha here gives you the percentage reduction in vehicle unit cost due to the savings of driving costs. And here we are not assuming that the vehicle costs will go to zero, but we are saying they're going to be somewhere between zero and one. So they are not going to increase, they are going to reduce, to decrease. On the other hand, we are also saying that the cost of providing increased vehicle capacity will increase due to automation, because automated vehicles are going to be more expensive. So we are going to have a beta that is greater or equal to one. Now, previous research in general ignores this and assume that beta is one. And as we will see later, based on our analysis, it seems, our estimations, calculations, whatever, it seems that we get something like 1.09 to 1.12. So it is not really a huge increase. And if it makes your life easier, assuming that this beta is equal to one is not the end of the world. So if we replace the cost here and here, these two terms that we added, we also want to be conservative, and we add another Greek letter here, gamma, which multiplies the running time because the speeds of the current automated shuttle pilots are low. As we saw before, they are 15 to 25 kilometers. You can say 12 to 20 kilometers per hour, or, you know, I don't know, 8 to 15 miles per hour. So we are adding this multiplier here to see how this affects. And just as a reference, the comparison here is not 10 miles per hour versus 50 miles per hour. That is the speed that we would expect a bus to go. The actual average speed of a bus in a city is closer to 10 miles per hour, right? So here, it's not such a big change that is introduced due to this, but there is some, and we consider it. And this also affects, of course, the end vehicle time, because if the vehicle is slower, that would influence this as well. So this was kind of the modeling, and now we try to do the empirical estimation of the parameters alpha and beta, and we use data from three cities, Munich, Berlin, and Santiago in Chile. And okay, we kind of cheat in the sense that the only difference between Munich and Berlin is the difference in the salary. For the others, which was a lot of work, and I'll get back to this on the next slide, essentially we assume the same information. So essentially, you see the salary of the monthly gross salary of the driver is more than double in Germany than in Chile. And of course, this is a good way to try to understand what happens, because the actual vehicles, the price does not change so much. Okay, in Munich, maybe we would buy German ones, in Chile, maybe Chinese ones. And yes, there is a range, but that's not the biggest determinant, but salary also plays a role. Then that's the left part of this slide. If we look at the right part of this slide, we are looking at the cost of adding automation to new vehicles. And this comes from the literature. And the point here is to consider that things will drop in price, right? This is helpful in motivating the values that we are using. So right now, buses are very expensive. They are an order of magnitude more expensive than vehicles easily. Automation right now is also very expensive. But the point is that if we look a little bit in a couple of decades, then this will change a lot. This is expected to change a lot. I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but I just want to give you an idea of the type of data that we had to collect. And honestly, that was not simple. This is not information that you can get very easy from the public transport authority or from the manufacturers or. So we have to double check and verify and contact from, you know, the public transport operators to different manufacturers, to researchers in the field and so on, to come up with these numbers. For different sizes, vehicle sizes, because that's also an important parameter that we are considering in this research. And in fact, we are considering the fact part of offering improved public transport service is if you can offer more smaller vehicles rather than few larger ones to which you are usually tied when you have to have a driver per vehicle. That, of course, is the main cost. And this gives you a little bit of the type of analysis, the regression that was done in order to understand how increasing vehicle capacity, going to a larger vehicle, increases the operator cost. So this is the beta parameter that we were discussing about before. And here we are talking about vehicles that are operator human driven. Then the other extreme, which is much lower, is vehicles where the cost of the operator, of the human, is zero. And then somewhere in between, not really in between, we have the cost of the operator when we have half of the operator cost, which again, it might mean less skilled operators. It might be because they don't have to drive, they just have to be there and, you know, reassure the people that things are going well and contact the center if something happens. Or they might be at a control center and are waiting to take over the bus if something happens, or whatever, reassure the drivers and so on. And this is at the end of, after we replace all these things, the end solution of the optimization model. So what happens here is we look at the optimal frequency, the optimal vehicle capacity, the optimal fare, and the optimal subsidy. And we see, for example, that a number of curves here. So the straight curve, the solid curve, sorry, is what happens with human-driven vehicles. And then this, you know, with dotted line is the dotted line in the case that we have zero operator cost and the vehicles, the speed does not create a penalty. So we assume that the automated vehicles will be as fast overall in the cycle as the normal ones. And then we see that we can increase the frequency very much. Of course, if the cost of the, if the speed of the vehicles decreases, becomes half, then we can not increase the frequency of the vehicles so much. If we assume that the personnel, I hope you can view my, can you view my cursor? Okay, great. Because I was making that assumption. So this curve here is the curve where we have a speed same, so the speed of the automated vehicles or same as the one of the conventional vehicles, but only half of the cost of the personnel. Still, we can improve the frequency. And if we assume that we both need half of the personnel cost and the speed is halved as well, then now, unfortunately, this is a case where we cannot maintain even the frequency that we had before. And these results are reflected also here inversely. So here we are talking at the optimal vehicle capacity, and in terms of the capacity, lower is better. So we see the same ordering that we see here, so that we can offer more frequent service with this service, etc. This is reversed. We can also offer lower capacity, smaller shuttles for this case, where the cost of the personnel is zero and the speed is maintained and so on. And only the case where the cost of the personnel cost of operating an automated shuttle is half of that of a conventional shuttle, and the speed of this automated shuttle is half of that of the original, the conventional shuttle, then unfortunately we cannot offer the same capacity. And I don't need to repeat this four times. We also see with the differentiation here that we can also offer lower fare in the most positive, favorable scenarios, and also with lower optimal subsidy. So it seems that with most of these setups, and also with, I may argue, relatively conservative assumptions, we're not saying, you know, costs will be eliminated, this and that, we can offer, or public transport operators at some point might be able to offer smaller shuttles, more frequent, at a lower cost and with a lower subsidy. So this concludes the second part. There is also a similar analysis that shows that there is also some economies of scales and this can improve more, but I didn't want to spend too much time and go too deep into this for now. So I'm taking this to the next step where I'm saying, okay, now we analyzed, we made some models and so on. So let's try to take this at the network level. Okay, let's try to see the impact of autonomous dynamic van pooling. And this is a project that we have with, it's funded from the German and the Chinese NSF equivalents. And It is a collaboration with Professor Hai Jiang from Tsinghua University. And again, I'm not going to go through the entire flowchart here. The idea is that we have a simulation model and a demand model. So the simulation model can model in detail the interactions between all the vehicles and so on, something we did not have before in our analytical model, and something that our Chinese colleagues do not have when they evaluate their scheduler. So their scheduler assigns requests for van pools in an optimal way, but making some assumptions regarding the travel time of the shuttles to each of them and so on. By pairing their scheduler with our simulator as a lower level, we now have an interaction and a more complete ecosystem where the impact, for example, of ambient traffic congestion and so on can affect the performance in their model. So we are using this to get a better sense of the interactions and so on, and not only an analytical model, and of course evaluate many other things like the things that I'm going to show you now. So we have developed a number of models in Munich. One is the larger Munich network, and the one that we'll use some results for now is a smaller, the downtown, well, it's not downtown because it's still, I don't know, 6 by 6 or 7 by 7 kilometers. So it's not, or like, I don't know, 4 by 4 miles. So it's not really a small area. This Mittlere Ring here is actually the inner ring of Munich. So this is not really the downtown. This is a real network. And the one argument to go here is, of course, that we want to minimize the runtime and make it more feasible. But also somebody would argue that these shuttles, these shared shuttles, are not so relevant for very remote areas, but they are for more in the closer to the center of the city. And again, the purpose of these services is not like those that are usually offered in remote areas where we have low demand and we do not want to offer, or we cannot offer, regular public transport service, but it's just an alternative for denser systems. You have to have a critical mass and more requests. And the kind of analysis that we can do here is by varying the number of requests served and the number of vans to see how, by the color of these points here, which tells us the additional time that is spent, and by the size of these points, which tell us the vehicle kilometers that are being saved, we can see the various impacts that we can have. And of course here, you know, the student did not have enough time to run the 20 vans case, and you know, this will never be run, it will be a way for us to remember him, but anyway. But in general, you can see, for example, why do we stop here to 70 requests? Because with 5 vans, we cannot serve more than 70 requests. And then by the change of the color here, essentially we can see sort of a Pareto frontier, sort of a frontier of what we can serve with a number of additional time and vehicle kilometers or vehicle miles saved. Now, just something to mention, when we have people doing individual trips, one person per trip, and we take these people and put them together in an Uber share or whatever, Uber Pop, whatever it's called, or a shared van here, what we do is they lose time, okay, because there is deviation, and the vehicle saves vehicle kilometers, right? Because it doesn't have to serve every trip, but it kind of aggregates. So here, there is another way to kind of look at these things, but gives us a similar idea. It's another way to show the same results. Here, we look a little bit at the environmental impacts, which of course is very important and a hot topic. And what we see here is that as the number of requests served increases, for different numbers of vans, so the red bullets here are the 5 vans, these blue X's are the 10 vans, the green things are the 15, and so on, all the way down to 30 for the orange. We see that, of course, as the number of requests increases, and for the same number of requests rather, sorry, as we increase the number of vans, the emissions are reduced. Okay? And what we are trying to say is that here we operate only at this bottom, at this small amount. And we, of course, cannot extrapolate, and I cannot stress it enough that I'm not saying that we can extrapolate. But wouldn't it be nice? Just a point, something for us to look at next. Now, a next thing is to use this kind of framework to try to understand a little bit some price control mechanisms. So how can we use pricing to improve the operation of such a system? And essentially here we have a set of exogenous variables and endogenous. So exogenous are the pricing method, okay? So this is a fixed thing, you change it and you determine the trip fare, and then we also have the attributes of the various transport modes, and we have the vehicle fleet size, which is not something that you can, you know, change dynamically. And we also have, in terms of the endogenous variables, the passenger preferences, which lead to ride sharing requests. So the passengers consider all the modes and they choose that they will use a shared van. So now this results in the ride sharing requests. The ride sharing requests result to a detour time, because if I have more requests, I have a larger detour time. They also lead to a waiting time change. They affect the waiting time of the other people or themselves, which in turn affects the passenger preference. And the vehicle fleet size affects the vacant seat hours. So if you have more vehicles, then you should have more vacant seat hours, which are affected also by the number of requests, and they affect the detour time. So intuitively, I think this kind of makes sense. So now we are developing a model where we say the number of requests essentially come from something like a simple mode choice model, where we say that the number of requests for the shared van are the total demand times the probability of choosing this shared van, which it comes from a logic model, probit, whatever. This is fairly standard. The only interesting thing is that this depends on the perceived utility of each mode, and this depends on this, on the number of requests. So here we have one of these nice fixed point problems that we so much love and enjoy. And you know, the interaction actually is not very simple, because this utility has to do with the time that is being spent in the vehicle, and this is this component. It has to do with the waiting time, and it has to do with the cost. And each of these has a beta, which is a coefficient, which captures the preference of the people, especially how averse they are towards waiting versus being served versus paying dollars. And besides this beta, then we have the component of the time and the service time, the waiting time, and the fare. So here we have the time of the trip plus the time of the detour. Here we have a component in the denominator of the number of vacant seat hours, okay, and so on. So we see here that we have a number of a system of simultaneous equations that need to be solved in order to figure this thing out. And I had a brilliant student that I'm really trying to, master student who did this, who I'm trying to keep as a PhD student as well, who did this analysis. So essentially, he solved this problem for two scenarios, for a monopoly optimum and for a system, best first social optimum case. And we understand these two are different. Some parameters, he did this for the Munich network, assuming, okay, what we call low demand from the demands that we have, and using some parameters from another, from an SP survey that we did in Munich. And essentially what he found is that in the monopoly optimum, you offer, the solution offers fewer vehicles, okay? So it's to the left of the social optimum. So it offers fewer vehicles at a higher price. And it makes sense. And from the viewpoint of the operator, this is the optimal solution. From the point of view of the society, it is better to offer more vehicles at a lower price. You still do not lose, but this is the social optimum with a different objective function. You don't really maximize profit, you maximize social welfare. And then this is where it became very interesting, where he came up with the existing idea that we said that here there is the concept of level of service that we have. We used a lot of in transport, but I think even in all fields, even if it's not existed, it's simple to understand. Once you have nobody else on the road, you are at level of service A. When it increases, you have B. When you have to pay attention to change lane, you are maybe at C. When you start to be restricted in your lane changes, you are D, and you go all the way to E, and F is gridlock. So here we are at a situation where we say, let's say that we start from the original utility that people have, and they have a low, a not very nice level of service. And let's say that we start paying some of them so that their utility increases, okay? Because the utility is a combination of various things. It's the waiting time, the service time, but it is also the cost. So if we give them back part of the cost, then we can improve a little bit their willingness and their satisfaction with the system. So, and we can influence the operation of the system. So this is something that is relatively early, but this is one idea. So we don't have fixed prices for everybody, but we play with the prices that we offer to different respondents. And of course there are equity issues. There are all sorts of issues that I'm not touching. So I have 5 minutes left, and I will very briefly talk about two things. That of course, there are other things like urban air mobility or advanced air mobility that we're talking right now. And for me, this is one very good example of trying to keep our brain in our head. So last year we did, along with TUM, along with the University of Applied Sciences at Ingolstadt and a research center here in Munich, the feasibility study for urban air mobility for Upper Bavaria. And what I keep from that is at the end, we found that the maximum, we made several scenarios that said in 2050, urban air mobility will be between 0 and maximum 1.5% of the trips. So maximum taxi in Munich. And the people from the ministry and from the project trigger, the DLR that was handling the project told us, okay, we enjoyed this because you did it in a very objective way and not like, oh, well, everybody will be, let's throw our cars away and sell them and buy flying taxis. It is important to keep that in mind. And last thing, which I think is very interesting because I talk a lot about technology, but it is also very important to look at low-tech things or mid-tech. So this is another research that we did again with Alejandro Tirakini and Manos Hanyotakis and another PhD student of mine, Mohamed Aboulela. We had the great benefit of having access to the users of a service in Mexico City called Yeti, which is high tech in the sense that it operates through an app like Uber, Lyft, and so on. But other than that, it's regular vehicles. And they offer this service for as a premium service for people commuting with small cars, vans, small buses, large buses. And we had access in a very privacy respecting way and so on, sending you know, anonymized tokens to them, to 14,000 of their users, so that they, we send them the questionnaire. More than 3,000 questionnaires came back, to almost 2,500 were complete, and we analyzed more than 2,100 because we could merge these with trip data from the operator, again, anonymous, etc. This is just an idea of the richness of the socioeconomical characteristics that we got. And in, we were able to analyze various things like this. Here, we see that most of the factors, so we see the most important factors are, first of all, booking of seat, security against theft, travel time, reliability, etc. And these were consistent across both sexes and other things. But security against harassment was expectedly a very big role between for women. And the most important thing is that, because this is a big, big issue everywhere, do these services, can these services contribute in reducing vehicle miles traveled? And without going into more details, what we found is that only vans, medium vans, so vehicles with the capacity to carry between 13 and 17 passengers, seem to have a potential to reduce vehicle miles traveled in this setup with these parameters. But cars, buses, cars and buses seem to have the opposite effect. And with that, I would like to thank you. The last thing, because I talk automation and you see I'm trying to keep a balanced, a fair and balanced scope, is this video that is very well known. This is an automated intelligent vehicle that is trying to merge here in the left, but because the uncivilized but smarter humans are not letting it merge, it goes off and exits in the next exit. So with that, I would like to thank you. And of course, I'm available for discussion, questions, and so on, going back deeper in some of these things or something else related.
Thank you very much for a wonderful talk. Join me in virtually thanking our speaker. We have about 10 minutes or so for some questions. So I invite you to unmute yourself or and ask the question or enter it into the chat box. If I guess while people are thinking about it, I did have one question on this last piece that you just mentioned about only vans having a net decrease in vehicle miles traveled when used for carpool. Because I think that's a very interesting result and maybe somewhat counterintuitive, because you would assume that anytime you can get two people to share a trip instead of two people driving, you're reducing vehicle miles traveled. Can you say a little more? I mean, I'm wondering if that's just because you're not, there's sort of an extra induced demand somewhere else. And so you're not reducing, in a car you can only fit so many people in, and so you're not reducing enough to offset the increase? Or do you have a sense for why that's the case?
Yeah, so this is, I didn't mention it. So as discussed, we had a lot of information about the origin and destination of these travelers. And this is not a door-to-door service. They have to reach specific stops. And okay. We look at the door-to-door vehicle kilometers. So the fact that people have to go and reach at some point, the point where a car or a van or a bus will take them, we also have to consider that part, because maybe they need to change their mode. They would use a different mode to go from their origin to the destination, but now they might change their mode in order to go to the start point and the end point.
Okay.
So this is a system-wide, so to speak. The other thing that I need to clarify is that the one thing we did not have is the percent of empty kilometers. So there we had to make an assumption, and this is what the columns of this table reflect.
Okay. But so that sort of makes sense then, because it's not an Uber or Lyft, it's a carpool where you can get some of the route miles taken care of, but you still have first mile, last mile possibly that you have to account for yourself.
And for some of these trips, I mean, it's mind blowing for me, because Mexico City, I knew it was a big city, but I mean, some of these trips are long. They're like a couple of hours each way. And maybe you are served for the middle 1 hour through this system, but you still have to do some other thing. And in a sense, it's not so counterintuitive because small vehicles have inefficiencies, larger vehicles have inefficiencies. So maybe somewhere in between there is a sweet spot. And this is why we can tie this with the previous research with the analytical model, where I said it's better to be able to offer service with smaller vehicles. So instead of large buses, with smaller buses, because this is optimally better in terms of the buses, but also if you move, if by being more flexible, you take people out of individual vehicles or car sharing, ride sharing, you know, cars again and put them there, you win from both sides, or you may win.
So the second part, I really like that. You broke out the sort of different scenarios that could happen and looked at different outcomes. And it's not just assuming one possible scenario, but it's sort of any one of these things could happen, and any one of them could happen in any combination. And then we have a possible outcome in terms of how the, in terms of what the cost looks like and how profitable it is, right? If I understood that.
So you're looking back at this thing, right?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Now, I was sort of wondering, do we have a sense of how likely any one of these scenarios are? I mean, I assume the answer is look into more literature and try to, but because it'd be nice to see sort of which ones of these outcomes are likely, which ones of those are unlikely, and then based on for each of these, what's the most likely final outcome? Does that question make sense?
Yeah, it does. And this is why my collaborators hate me, because of course I'm not going to do the work, they're going to do it. So whenever they give 1 point or 2 points, I say, let's do a sensitivity analysis. Let's have a range and let's see what happens. Because honestly, we are not only sitting passive and looking at what will emerge. We have the opportunity to steer that. We have to feed that. So if we convince now, in Europe, a lot of the fund of the research happens at the European level, and a lot of this is meant to guide European policy and evidence-based policy, as we like to say. So from these things, I think the outcome can be clear, push towards this direction. Maybe in the next call where you call for because the European Union spends a lot of money for soft research like ours, models, etc., but real money for green trains, green planes, green buses, energies, etc. And there, the right topics, the right calls where they say, make a cheaper autonomous bus or a green bus. If the buses, like the buses we see now, or they push hard for 15 seaters or 20 seaters or 7 seaters, that will, if that's where the money is, that's where the developments will come.
Okay, I see. So it's an iterative process, because the outcome depends on what the findings are, and the findings will right.
So and I'm not the expert to say which size of buses is the best one, honestly, right?
No, but that makes sense, because I mean the outcomes of this can definitely guide policy in the future, and then determine which one of these outcomes will end up happening.
So I have a question. So among this, there is also the drone version, where there is a central operator that can operate more than one vehicles when the need arises, or when they enter the location where the automation is not enough. Where is this scenario going right now?
I'm not sure I get it. What do you mean? Because all these are an operator that operates many vehicles.
Yes. So, yeah. So in terms of when you said about investment in Europe, where does this scenario go? Because here we don't consider it that much. So are there systems investments where they're planning on operating a drone type of public transport?
Flying, you mean, on the air?
No. I'm talking drone by the sense that there is an operator, but the operator is not on the vehicle. The operator is on a remote location that can operate more vehicles.
I understand now what you mean. Yeah. So exactly, this is our intermediate scenario where we say that the cost of operation is going to be 50% because you don't have one driver for each vehicle, but instead you have somebody sitting in an office remotely operating three or four of these vehicles, so you can have this. I mean, right now I do not know of anybody offering this service, and given I'm not even sure that you can be certified and you can be allowed to do it given the cybersecurity concerns and so on. But it is an option. So I'm not a technologist, I'm not a mechanical engineer, I don't design this, but I believe that with these scenarios where we say that the human operator cost will be 50%, and we can assume, I mean, it's very easy for us now to run it for 30% or whatever once we have the model, it covers this case. So this is exactly the intermediate case that we're mentioning.
I think it looks like we're almost out of time. So let's thank our speaker again. Thank you very much for giving this virtual Warren lecture. It's nice to continue the lecture series, even when we can't be present in the civil engineering building in person. So thank you very much. And thanks everyone for attending. I really appreciate everyone showing up today and listening to our speaker. Thanks a lot, Kostas.
Thanks a lot for the invitation, Rafael, and everybody for being here. Such a wonderful audience. It has been a pleasure.
Thank you.